Thanks for taking the time to watch or listen into this sermon. Our prayer is always that God would use it to draw you closer to Himself and deepen your love for Jesus Christ. It's also our hope that this sermon would not be used to replace God's plan for authentic relationships in your life through a local church. If you aren't already a member of a local church, we just want to encourage you to step out in faith and join a church somewhere near you. Thanks again for checking out this sermon. We pray it's a blessing to you.
So, we've been in a series called Mission. We started at the beginning of the year, and we are ending it today. If you've missed any or all of them, you'll be fine today. We'll be just great together today. And then next week, we start a new series. And so make sure you're here for that. The new series is called Church on Fire, and we're going to go through the book of Acts for several months together. And I'm super amped about that. And really, we're going from a really exciting series to another really exciting series. And so I just hope that you'll be a part of that because I think you'll be inspired. I think you'll be inspired as we go through the book of Acts. When we see God's Spirit working through regular people to do phenomenal things, it's encouraging, exciting to get on board with God's up to. And yeah, so I hope you're here for that. But let me pray and then jump into today's message. God, we thank you for the opportunity to be here. We count it as that, an opportunity. God, that we are amongst your people, in your presence, singing your praises and opening your word. God, I pray that you would do in us what only you can do. God, we ask for a transformative work in our hearts, our minds, and our lives that you would get the glory for and that we would benefit from. In Jesus' name, amen. So we've been in a series called Mission, and each week I've kind of gone through a big chunk of who we are as a church, the mission that we're on, our mission statement, our value statements, and our vision. And I know that the first part can kind of feel like a board meeting or some sort of organizational gathering, and on some level it is, but I don't want it to feel clunky to work through. Let me just tell you this. We're going to look at what it means to be the Roots Community Church, but if we look down deeper, we're going to realize what it means to be a church of Jesus followers, and really, if you push it down even further, you'll realize what it means to be one of Jesus' followers. And so let me just kind of lay out what we've talked about the whole series quickly, and then jump into or zoom into what we're going to look at today. And so first, the mission statement of the church is this: the Roots Community Church exists to glorify God. Now, let me just say, when I say the Roots Community Church, that is not just myself or some branding or just the leadership team, but any and all people that follow Jesus and that this is their home church are the Roots Community Church. So if that's you, own this. Own this, because we don't do these things unless we do these things. The Roots Community Church exists to glorify God. And we do that because the most fundamental reason why all of us exist is to glorify God. The chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. That we would be most satisfied when he is most glorified. And so that everything else is kind of built around and stands on that. And so if you haven't been here through this series, I would encourage you at least to go back and listen to that first one. Because everything points back to that. We're doing it all for God's glory. The Roots Community Church exists to glorify God by reaching all lost, discipling all found, equipping all disciples, and sending all equipped. Now, this is a vision that never can stop. This is a mission that never will stop until Christ comes back. And the reason is because we're on God's mission. And that in this, our hope is that lost people would become found, that we would reach all lost. Well, that's pretty daunting. That's billions of people that don't know Christ. And so that should be at least enough for all of us to keep busy. That we would be reaching all lost in every way possible. And we've kind of categorized that as two ways. One, fill the seats, and two, fill the streets. And when I say fill the seats, depending on your church background, you might feel like that's some sort of church growth strategy. On some level it is, because the church is the believers and we want more people to believe in God. But really what we're saying is there is something amazing that happens when the people of God gather underneath the word of God being proclaimed. And that many of us could talk about times in our lives, maybe the first time in our life where we gave our heart to Christ, that that's what happened. We came amongst other people that followed Jesus. Someone told us about who he is through his word, and God revealed something inside of us, and it completely changed us and our future. And so we believe in that. We want as many people as possible to sit underneath the gospel as often as possible. The second part of that was fill the streets. That it's not just about gathering all people to one place, but that we would scatter and that everywhere we go as believers, we would take the gospel. That we would go and bring light into dark spaces. We'll talk about that a little bit today, but that we would reach all lost by the gathering and the scattering. Reach all lost. That we would disciple all found. That we would take on ourselves the responsibility that once someone, God has drawn them to himself, that he has not only connected them with the head that is Christ, but with the body that is his church. And that he has done so because he has made us to be relational. It's best for us to do this together. As we teach each other, we disciple each other on what it looks like to obey the commands of Christ. The next one there is equip all disciples, that as we're following after Christ, we start to realize that God has shaped, built, and created us uniquely to fit inside of his body. And in that pillar, that place of our mission statement, that we would be equipping people to fulfill what God has called them to do. That would help them to assess their life and their history and their gifts and passions, desires, and see, okay, how has God crafted me to bring him the most glory with my life? And that I would find satisfaction in using everything he's given me for his purposes. And the last part is sending all equipped, that now that I understand that I have the tools, the resources, that I would be pushed out into what God has for me. That we would send. That we would not just be about what can we do and what can we grow here as our own thing, but that there would be a piece of pushing people out of the nest that are prepared to leave us. So we talked last week, we're planting a church this year. September of 2017 will be the beginning of the services. But that means there's a lot of work that goes on before that in that community. And that we'll be planting a church in Tacoma in 2017. And that means, well, really that it's time for us to put up or shut up. That we say we're going to send equipped people. So if we're going to do that, let's do it. One of the best things that we could possibly do is push people further out into the world to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ and the love of God through Christ. And so that we're sending some of our best people, some of our best resources to a space that isn't here for the purpose of God being glorified as people walk out what he has called them to do and be. And it's very exciting and it's new for us. And so there's a little bit of, oh man, but I love that. Because that's that space where we're fully dependent on God. And we get to see the amazing things he does as he also exposes some of our own stuff in that. And so the cool thing about that is that the mission continues to cycle, because now that people are equipped and sent, their goal in being sent is to reach people that are lost, to disciple them, equip them, and send them. That it would be a multiplying effort that would be pushed forth to push forth the kingdom. And so that's the mission of who we are at the Roots Community Church. Our value statements, some of our value statements that are closely connected with that mission statement are we love God and we love people and we want more people to love God. Seems basic, but it's easy to say I love people. Loving people. I mean, have you met people? No, but that's real. We love God and we love people and want more people to love God. We live life together. Transformed by God's word and his spirit, that we believe that this is not a solo mission, that he has called us to walk this life out together and really do life together. I don't mean, like, listen, we primarily push people towards things called community groups where we gather and talk about life and how God's doing a work in us through things like the message and our Bible reading, those things, which are great. they're only effective if we actually allow ourselves to do life together. That in those moments, even if it's not as often as some may want, that we're really doing life on life, that we're showing, like, this is who I really am, this is who you really are. We can handle that, and we can grow together in Christ. We learn to most glorify God with all things, that we steward things and realize that it's all His and not our own. We lead everywhere that God places us. We're going to zoom in on that statement today in just a moment. But let me finish the rundown here of the mission, values, and vision. The vision, we just understand as a church that it's not just about us, that God has a plan to work through us for the good of others. And so we decided early on in the starting of the church that we would sow, go, and grow, that we would give outside of ourselves for the pushing forth of God's word and His love in places that we're not going, but that other people are. And so we've partnered several times outside of ourselves here locally and globally to make sure that that happens. To go, that we would get out and that we would, again, bring the gospel other places outside of just our little gatherings and holy huddles. And so regularly, we go on a local level to people that are lost, and then in 2.5 weeks, 3 weeks, there's a group of 10 people that are going to Guatemala. To take the love of God and the message of Jesus Christ to Guatemala. We're going to serve in an orphanage. We're going to serve in a village, building a widow's home. It's going to be an awesome time. And then grow. And that's the part which I already spoke on long enough that I don't need to right now. We'll multiply His kingdom through the planting of churches, that we would start churches where we're currently not at. Knowing that it's proven that the best form of evangelism is to move to a place and stay there. It's missions, but it's long-term missions. Like life missions. And that we would go into a place and love you every day and declare the gospel every day and live life together every day would have a real effect for the gospel. And so that's what we're going to be doing this year. So with all that being said, that was the big overview that I got a little more in depth than I was going to. And today we're going to zoom in on the last value statement. We lead. Excuse me, I have a little bit of a sniffle. We lead everywhere that God places us. Now, some of you instantly when I say that are going to have to wrestle through some things. Because maybe leadership for you, you have a negative example of what leadership should be that someone has given you. Maybe of yourself, you think, I don't know if I'm the leader type. I'm more of a follower. I hope that you'll realize that we're leaders because we follow the greatest leader. And that we're called to lead people to Him. And that it might not be because of position or title, but we've still been given the charge. And so we lead everywhere that God places us. I'm going to emphasize that for a moment, where God places us. God decided that this is the time that you would live. Some of us think that's unfortunate. Guess what? You can't change it. There must be purpose behind it. And so as long as I'm in this generation that He's called me to be in, how do I most glorify Him? By leading everywhere He has placed me. One of the places He's placed me in is in time. He's placed me in location. Currently, we're all here. And most of you live in this community. Maybe some of you don't, but wherever you are and you do stay, and today you're here, when you go back there, that's where you're at. And you might not be there for a long time, but that's where you currently are. And so you have to understand that you're placed there for a reason. That there is ways to glorify God in that place, in this season. Relationships, whether in or out of them, the place that you're at right now. How to lead in what it looks like to be in that. So if you aren't in a relationship, how do you lead in what it looks like to glorify God in singleness? If you are in a relationship, how do you lead in what it looks like to glorify God in a marital relationship or a dating relationship or a parent-child relationship or a neighbor relationship or a coworker relationship? How do we walk that out, that we lead everywhere that God has placed us? And then in the body, in the body. You should believe that God has placed you in the body. The Bible says that he does. In fact, it says that God decides where in the body he places you. And so that we should learn how do I best lead in the place that I'm positioned, not because of the title. I hope you're hearing me right now. How do I lead wherever I'm at in the stage of life that I'm in? So if life right now seems like I'm a success, how do I lead in glorifying God in success? If life right now seems like a struggle and suffering, how do I lead in following God and what it looks like to glorify him through brokenness and pain? That there is glory for him to be given regardless of circumstance and situation. And so how do I lead in doing that? Because sometimes we only decide to lead in what it means to glorify God when it's easy. Like everybody, it's an easy like, well, thank God for when everything's great. But that in all spaces, as I'm wrestling, struggling, working through things, leading everywhere that God places us. I'm going to give you some ways to do that today. Lead with light, or leading by shining. In Matthew 5, it's the Sermon on the Mount, and Jesus says this to the crowd that is gathered. You are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. Which is interesting, because in John it says that the true light came in to the world, which is Jesus. But then Jesus says, you're the light of the world. That he's given us responsibility to carry on. That as his people, we would shine in darkness. That Jesus, we would be transparent and he would shine through us in all spaces that we go. And you can do that from wherever you're at. You can shine as the one giving a handout, or you can shine even as the one receiving a handout. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. You know, we should think of that not only individually, but holistically as his people. You are the light of the world. A town on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. That by our actions in following after Christ and our grace-driven efforts to bring him glory, that people would see those and would see that there is light in those, and that we would be able to point to the Father that he would get glory. Now listen to this. Sometimes when we hear that you should do your deeds before others, we can very quickly turn into becoming self-righteous. We can very quickly be like, oh, look, we're supposed to shine. I'm going to see who shines brighter between me and another light. And Christianity and church can get like that. Instead of us all being concerned about taking light into dark spaces, we can just gather and go like, well, I'm brighter than you are. Look at all my actions. That's self-righteousness. The goal of the action of good work is driven by the grace we have received to the glory of the Father. Not unto ourselves, that it wouldn't be that, hey, look how bright I can be, but look at the light of Christ shining through me. And that's where we would push people towards. That we could lead by shining, or lead with light in all places. That we would lead by serving, or lead with service. This is an interesting space in Scripture. Right before what we're going to read here, in Matthew 20, two brothers, grown men, James and John, they approach Jesus, not by themselves. Their mother brings these two grown dudes who are Jesus' disciples to Jesus and has a request to Jesus. Jesus, can you give my two sweet boys... She doesn't say that in Scripture. These positions of leadership, can one of them sit on your right and one of them sit on your left? that I know you got all these disciples, but could they be just special ones in places of rule and authority? First off, this is just kind of funny. These are two dudes that Jesus has called to follow after him, and they're grown, and their mom came to give them requests for preference. I get it, moms. I get it. Just realize something. If you do that for your sons, especially grown ones, they're going to get beat up by their friends. You're not helping. Just encourage them. Love on them. Coach them. So Jesus basically says, can you drink this cup I'm going to drink? And he kind of goes through this back and forth with them, saying that that's not the way it works. Mom can't just come and you get this special position. And then the Bible says that the other 10 disciples, there's 12 disciples, there's only two of them. The other 10, the Bible says, have some issues with the fact that that happened. I get it. You'd have issue too. And Jesus responds to all the disciples like this. Jesus called them together and said, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles or of the nations lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. He's saying this is what we would say is secular leadership or worldly leadership. And right here specifically, he's just saying basically wicked leadership. This is what people that abuse power look like. Those that are in these ruling roles, they use their authority against the people. Basically, it's for their benefit that they're leaders and that everybody else just has to serve them, so it's good for them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you. I can't imagine being James and John at this point. Like, all the guys are mad, and you're amongst the 12. And Jesus says, like, some people like to have these leadership roles so they can abuse them. Not so among you. This is what it looks like to be, if you want to be great, this is what you do. And they're the two that are like, yeah, we came with mom, we wanted to be great. Like, I just wonder how that looked. I wonder how that looked. Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Man, what a dynamic change there. It flips it all on its head. That you want to be great? You want to be first? He uses terms of the lowest two positions in their community. Then you have to be the servant. You have to be the slave. And he can say that. Because in Jesus saying that you should humble yourself to this sort of level and a sort of giving of self sacrificially is the one that has most humbled himself in all of history. As the Son of God that would come from heaven and into his own creation to be born as a baby into this world, live a perfect life, and then in our place, take our sin and the punishment due our sin, dying a brutal death on the cross. 3 days later, showing that he had power over death and over the punishment for our sins. He raised again, came up from the grave. Was on the earth for a while, seen and dealt with by people he's in relationship with. He ascended into heaven and he sits on the throne. That no one has ever come from a higher place or come to a lower place. And so in the truth of his humility, he speaks to his people that to be great and to be first is to come down. That all of us can lead because all of us can serve. That when I say it might not be in a role of title that you have leadership, we lead everywhere God places us. That we would be a light that shines and a people that serve. That places that we go would be better because we're there, because we add value. We're not looking for everyone to add value. I hope that that's us. I hope the places that we work, the families that we're a part of, the communities that we live in, that we would be those that come with the light of Christ and the servant heart as we follow after him, and that the community that we're a part of would be better because the Roots Community Church is in it. We lead by shining. We lead by serving. And then really all of it on a fundamental level, we lead by example. We lead by example. Paul says this, 1 Corinthians 11:1, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. We lead because we follow. When we follow Christ well, we can be point to as what it looks like to follow Christ. Follow me as I follow. Follow as I follow. I'm not the end result. I'm not the answer. Don't follow me because I got it all together. Follow me because I'm pursuing Christ, and that's where we should be on the journey towards. Many of us are afraid of statements like this, and I get it. It feels really weighty. It feels really weighty to look at somebody and say, follow my example. As I follow the example of Christ. You know why? Because we know we got problems. And so most of us have a hard time walking in the leadership that God has given us to lead people closer to him, because we're waiting until we feel like we're the perfect example. You're not. Christ is. Let me just free you of that. You're not. Christ is. And we wait until things are perfect before we start moving. And guess what? That it's going to be too late. You're going to be like standing before Jesus when that comes. But that I could lead by example, even if my example isn't always perfect, then I can be an example of what it looks like to imperfectly be an example. That in that, I could turn to somebody and say, listen, I know I told you I was following after Jesus. I'm messed up, man. I was grace-driven effort, and the old me, the dead me, the sinful me, I tripped on the old dead me again. But I'm confessing that, and I'm repenting. And I might not be an example of perfection, that's who Jesus is, but I am an example of what it looks like to follow after Jesus, even when I don't do it perfectly. You know, that's freeing. That's freeing for the person that's trying to be the example and for the one following. Because if somebody's following you and you say, follow me as I follow Christ, like I'm going to disciple you. If you're not careful, if you act like you have it all together, they might think that you have it all together. And they might think for them to follow Christ, they got to have it all together. And for them to be an example for somebody else, they got to have it all together. And if you're in this position and you're the one leading in that space, you can't handle that for long. Pretty soon, even if for a moment you seem like you have it all together, tomorrow you're a whitewashed tomb with dead bones inside because you put on this front, because you got to show everybody you got it all together because I said follow my example. So let me show you what it looks like to be perfect. No, you're not. You're not perfect. If you were, Christ wouldn't have had to come. He lived the perfect life you cannot live. That it's great time for us in those. Now, should we be growing in Christ? Yes. Transformed to the image of Christ from glory to glory, ever increasing? Yes. Will we fall on our face along the way? You better believe it. Do we need to make sure we have people around us that we can be honest with and helping us along that journey? Yes. Do we need to be honest with those that we are saying, follow me as I follow Christ? Yes, it'll be freeing for you and freeing for them. That is not a pass to say you could just wild out and be like, yeah, but God's got it covered. I can do whatever. He didn't save you to go sin. He saved you from sin. But that we're forgiven of our sins, past, present, and future. You guys still with me? Yeah. Leading by example. This is awesome. Paul, the Apostle Paul, planted all these churches. He writes a letter to Timothy, one of his disciples. And Timothy is placed in pastoral leadership at the church that he serves in. And Paul writes him this pastoral letter to talk to him about what it looks like in leading the people. And he says this to him in 1 Timothy 4, starting in verse 12. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, comma. If you stopped right there, you might be like, well, how's he going to do that? We've all been at a place where somebody looked down on us because we're young. How do you, he says, don't let them My first thought when I see don't let or don't allow is like, you better not do that again. You don't go there? Okay, cool. Because how do you stop somebody from looking down at you? And apparently my flesh says punk them. But listen, don't let anyone look down on you because you are young. And really, I think for some of us, we could kind of work through just the word young is all perspective for a lot of us. Because based on your age is what you think young is. And so for some of you, I'm young. He's trying to keep himself young. We're the same age. For some of you, you're like, you ain't been young for a long time, bro. I get it. It's because we kind of work through what that looks like. For all of us, we probably have places and positions where we feel like we're young. Either young in age or young to something. New to something. Or that somebody would look down on us because we're not quite there yet. And let me just tell you, this is an interesting statement because it's believed that Timothy at this time is probably in his mid-30s. So we'll just define it as that for now. I'm in my mid-30s for another like 2 weeks. So feels good. Feels good. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young. But listen, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. That's awesome. There's the way you don't allow people to look down on you because you're young. Because if you're the example setter, if you're the one that's going to grind and really do the hard work, what can someone look down their nose at you like, what, you don't get it? You're not there yet? If you're grinding on what it is. And you can see this play out in other areas of life, but specifically we're talking about our following after Jesus. I mean, you can see it in sports. You can see it in careers where somebody new to a place, people can go like, oh, they don't get it yet. But if they grind, guess what? You can't stay that long. You just can't. They don't allow you to because of the example they set. That all of us are called to set that example of what it looks like to follow after Christ wholeheartedly in the place that we're in, whether it's success or suffering and anything in between, whether it's a positional role of leadership or whether it's the lowest on the totem pole, that we would show what it looks like to most honor God with the place that he has placed us in the leading of what that looks like. In speech, so in talk and conduct, how we live our life, in love. Set an example in love, a sacrificial biblical love, in faith. And that means in the knowing of the faith, the following after Christ, and in purity, the walk in holiness. He says, until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preaching and to teaching. Do not neglect your gift, which was given you through prophecy when the body of elders laid their hands on you. Now, for you, that's not going to be specifically you because you're not Timothy. But I think you can go ahead and personalize some of that all of us should not neglect our gift. So for him specifically, it tells you what his gift is, right? That you should be preaching and teaching and doing these things. But for all of us, God has gifted us to most glorify him, to edify the body and strengthen the body, and to find satisfaction in our working that out and to be a witness to the world. Do not neglect it. Be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. That's what it is. That's what it is. And say, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. That there's progress that happens. Not that I'm perfect, but that I'm progressing. And will there be some of this along that progression? Probably. That we kind of stutter along the way, but that we be honest about that example. Watch your life and your doctrine closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Your life and your doctrine, your understanding of the gospel. The truths of who God is and who we are because of that. To watch your life and your doctrine closely, persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearer. What he's saying is, that's the gospel that saves. Stay on that. If you go off that, that's not a gospel that saves you. And it's not a gospel that saves anybody else. Persevere in the truths of the gospel. Let's keep moving. Leading by example, I want to spend a few minutes here in Titus chapter 2. I love this because it's going to talk about both men and women, both young and old. And so all of us are going to fall into some categories here, or a category here. Again, you'll probably deny some of them depending on how old you feel. You, however, must teach what is appropriate to sound doctrine. So again, this is a letter, a pastoral letter to be taught to the people. Teach what is appropriate to sound doctrine. So what is right in accordance with the gospel? What does it look like to play out in all of our lives? Teach the older men to be temperate or sober-minded, worthy of respect, self-controlled, and sound in faith, in love, and in endurance. Older men. Again, I'm not going to put an age on it. But if you're old enough to have a kid that has a kid, you might want to consider how close you are. Because it's talking generationally here. It's talking generationally. Older men, those that have gone through some of these things, that are before and ahead on this journey. Older men, be sober-minded, worthy of respect, not just forceful of it. Too often we want respect because we got older. Congratulations, you didn't die. I respect that. But that doesn't mean you live respectfully. It says worthy of respect. Self-controlled. Sound in faith. That means that there's a clarity of doctrine, theology, of the gospel. That the older men would be ones that are firm in their faith and the foundations of their faith in Christ. That we would be able to look and say, look it, they've had more years than us to figure this thing out. And they've pushed all the way through. They didn't kind of like get a little bit of an understanding and stop and kind of float on that, but that it was continually driven down. Sound in faith, in love, and in endurance. That the older men would show what it looks like to be sound in love and in endurance. Finishing strong. That the younger men, that I'm going to say I am for 2 more weeks at least. that the younger men and the younger women would have fathers in the faith. That would be firm and stability amongst us. That, listen, already in the world that we live in, a massive amount of people grow up without fatherly influence. And even if there is a father in the home, sometimes it's just a warm body. And maybe there's not an influence at all of someone, a man that would follow after Christ wholeheartedly for the long haul. And that the church, we should find those. We should be those. And some of you are, so this isn't like going after everybody. This is a reminder that you have a calling to lead. A calling to lead. That we would look to you to help us understand what it looks like. Endure. That the younger men could look up and go, that's what it looks like to be firm in the faith for the long haul. I want that. That's encouraging. Likewise, teach the older women. I'm not even going to put any sort of age, space, definition on that. Because I'd like to become an older man. Yeah. Likewise, it's a generational thing. These are women that have come before and wouldn't be considered in the younger women category. Teach the older women to be reverent in the way they live. That means the way they live would be in reverence to God, revering Him. The older women would revere God and show what it looks like to walk that life out. Not to be slanderers or addicted to much wine. I think everybody has the things they're more apt to go towards. And although I don't think this was written to Titus as a prophetic thing 2,000 years later, I think some things are true and still apply. That all of us are bent towards certain things. And so I know it's a stereotypical thing and people can kind of get that way. But what it says here is to live a life in reverence to who God is and live according to that, not given to slandering or to gossip or too much talk in a negative way about people or being addicted to wine or other drink. But they would set this example of what it means to be sober-minded, that their words would not slander, but would uplift, and would, it says, but teach to do what is right, to teach what is good. That there's an opportunity for the older women to teach the younger women what it looks like to revere God and what it looks like to follow after Him. And just like when I said that there's not enough older men doing those roles, we need older women to do those. And we have some great ones, both men and women in the church that do that. And we need more of it. Because there's young men and young women in desperate need of help. They need to know that what you have now, you probably didn't always have. But that you probably had some struggle. You probably went through some things. And some of what they're wrestling through is probably normal things to wrestle through and figuring out how to most glorify God with where they're at. So that we would have men and women that go before and set the example, set the tone, set the pace, and lead out in the space that they're in. Then they can urge the younger women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled and pure, to be busy at home, to be kind, to be subject to their husbands, so that no one will malign the word of God. Then they can urge the younger women to live reverent lives and revere Christ, not slanders, not given to wine, but teaching what is good. Then they'll be able to urge the younger women. That's necessary. You know, as your pastor, there's certain things I can say to about what the Bible says about what it is to be a young woman. That you're not going to hear from me? Never experienced that. I don't know. I can tell you what the Bible says. I think you should do it because it's the Bible. But it would be better to have a woman that's done it before or has worked through, is working through to urge you on to such things. To love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled and pure. So younger women, this is the things that it's teaching that you could lead out in. To be busy at home, which doesn't mean that you have to be a stay-at-home mom. If you are, that's cool. If you're not, that's cool too. But that you would understand the priority of working on your home. To be kind and to be subject to their husbands. Okay? Just that line alone could get me on a YouTube video clip going viral in the current culture. To be subject to their husbands, or the Bible would say to submit to or come under, it's a biblical teaching of how God has ordained leadership inside of the home. And I understand that there's many women that have stepped into greater roles of leadership that are not in that space, most often because there isn't a man present, or at least one that'll lead. And so although it brings things out of order and can bring chaos and it's not the right way to go, it's mostly been done out of default, out of necessity, because things still need to be led. And so there's a bunch of men that could, it's a great time to apologize and to be the things that the Bible tells us to be. So that there is safety in that submitting, in fact, that it gives strength, not fear. Similarly, this is interesting, encourage the young men to be self-controlled, period. That's all it says. If you've ever met a young man, you know. If they can get this one, you don't need a longer list. The energy and excitement that they have for things can get them to move on things without control. Sometimes even good things can be bad because it's not under control. And so it says for young men to be taught to be self-controlled. So in all of these seasons, there's not only the example you can set for the generation after, but there's an example you can set for the generation that you're in. In fact, for some, we could set examples for generations that have come before or after or the same as just by being an example of what it means to follow after Christ in the space that we're in. And that all of us would own that, that we lead where we're placed. If you're older, you're not going to be younger again. If you're younger, the clock is ticking. So that we would honor God in the spaces that we are, in the places that he's placed us. In everything, set them an example by doing what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness, and soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that those who oppose you may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about us. That we lead. We lead everywhere that God places us. And it might not be positional or a title or an office of leadership. But it is a calling that we are placed there for a reason. And sometimes we don't know the reason, but the one thing that we do know is that we're called to glorify God regardless of the space that he has us. I want to do this. I'm going to have the worship team come up. I would love for you, I didn't get to read it today, but in 1 Timothy chapter 3, talks about pastors in the church and deacons, and so leadership roles in the church. And one of the cool things about that list when you look at it is you would imagine, based on the way that there is like, well, in the world today, there's like celebrity pastors and things. It's pretty ridiculous. But you would imagine that pastoral ministry was like, oh, and here's the 72 skill sets you have to have so people are attracted to everything you want to do. But the Bible doesn't say that. It says the one thing you have to be able to do as far as like a skill is teach the word. Everything else is a biblical character quality. All the rest of it is, now set an example for the people. Set an example for the people. So it goes down this list of what it looks like to follow after Christ. And so there is a space where it says, you know, shouldn't be a recent convert. Why? Because I want to make sure that you know how to really set an example before you are given the office of example setter. Before you're given the title of, okay, you're the guy that sets examples for people. They want to wants to make sure that you understand that that's what it's about. Teaching the word clearly with sound doctrine, a gospel that is a saving gospel in Christ Jesus, nothing else. That we would repent from all of the ways. There's no other way. It's not in my own works, my own effort, my abilities. It is in the saving work of Christ Jesus. And me putting my faith in what he has already accomplished, that I am saved. So I have some questions that I want to leave you with today. We lead everywhere that God places us. First question, pretty simple. Where am I currently? Where am I currently? I'm here. The community I live in, the family I'm a part of, the friend group that I'm a part of, the job that I'm in, the church that I'm a part of. Where am I currently? And I think you should kind of assess the different spaces that you have opportunity to be an example of, of following Christ, of being a light, of leading by serving. Where are the spaces that I have an opportunity to do that? Where in the community? And how can I lead well there? I think you should write those out. Where am I and how can I lead well there? Again, for you, it might be some sort of title for you based on your capacity. You might have a bigger platform of influence that you can lead. But all of us, even if it's a very small platform, have the opportunity. So where is that? And how can I lead well there? How can I shine? How can I serve? How can I set an example? And the last question with that is, are there other places I should be leading? Are there other places I should be leading? Maybe I'm in these places now, maybe I'm doing that, but maybe it's clear that I have a gift set or a desire in a space that could bring God glory through me leading in that space. The Bible would say, if you've been given the gift of leadership, to do it diligently. So maybe some of you have a administrative leadership type of capacity that is not being utilized. And it's time to step into some of those roles because we all benefit from the leadership and example of others. Can you stand to your feet with me? The mission, the heart of today and why we would lead, and the mission of everything that we've talked about in reaching lost people and discipling and equipping and sending and loving and living and learning and leading and sowing and going and growing. In all of those, the hopes is to push forth the word of God and the love of God that is found in Christ Jesus. That all the works we talked about today are not works to earn grace, for then it wouldn't be grace. It would be a wage that God owes us. The Bible is clear. The wage we deserve for our sin is death. But that Christ died in our place, taking on our sin, giving us righteousness and life through him eternally. And our mission, now that he has captured our hearts and captured our lives, is to have him work through us to draw more people to himself, that they would be saved, that the bondage of sin would be broken off their life, that their eternity would change, that they would no longer have an eternity from God's love and only understanding his wrath, but instead an eternity where Christ has taken the wrath through their sins and they get to walk in the love of God through Christ forever. And that we would give our lives for that. There is no greater cause on this planet. There is no greater mission on this planet. That we could unapologetically live our lives on mission. God's mission for his glory, and we would find satisfaction in doing so. I want to pray with us. I want to pray with us, and after I pray, we're going to go into a song and we're going to worship God for being awesome. We're going to have prayer partners on the side of the room. If you need prayer for anything, I want to encourage you to go to one of those prayer partners. Everybody else will be singing. They won't be paying attention. Don't worry about it. But those prayer partners are ready and excited to add their faith to yours as you ask God to extend his mighty hand. And we have on the Connect cards a place for prayer requests. And for you, maybe that's a big step today. Maybe it's a big step to write down your prayer request. I want to encourage you, if I could, to take another step and to go to someone that has prepared themselves and could help you walk through the prayers that you're bringing before God. Also on the back of this card, it says, I'm ready to connect to Jesus, and I'm ready to connect to the roots. There's nothing more important than you can do than to start a relationship with God through Christ Jesus, not from your works, but through His. That you would be saved, set free, made pure, holy, and righteous because of what Jesus Christ has done. If you're ready to make that decision or another step along that journey with Him, I pray that you would take this to the Connect tent in the lobby after we're done singing. Where it also says, connect to the roots. I do not believe that you're built to do this on your own. God built in us a longing to be connected and in relationships. And so I want to encourage you to take that step, maybe a courageous step for you, to get involved and engaged with a local congregation of believers that love you and want to do this with you. So if you could fill that out and take it to the Connect tent after we're done singing. And then if you came ready to give today financially to honor God with your finances, there's offering boxes on both sides of the room that you can just drop that on the way out, or you can do that on the app. We believe in giving generously. We believe in honoring God with our finances. And we're on mission and to do some of the things we long to do on mission. Take resources, like, you know, planting a church and taking people on staff to do so. Take resources. And so I just want you to know that your dollars are mission focused. But more importantly than that is, even in your giving, that it is in the right space and heart of wanting to honor God in that way. So if you're ready to do those things, you'll get the chance right after we're done singing. But right now I want to pray, then we're going to sing. God, we thank you for the opportunity to be here. God, I thank you that you love us so much that you have drawn us into relationship with yourself. That God, even though we are imperfect, you have called us onto your perfect mission. God, help us to get past ourselves, our fears, our insecurities. God, that even in those, you would work through those and what it means to follow after you in that space. God, I thank you that we're not called to do this alone. Help us to connect with real relationships with each other. God, help us to be a light and to serve others, that we would lead in those ways as Christ is our light, and that He is the one who came to serve and not to be served. God, I'm sure you're up to many other things in people's hearts and lives right now as your Holy Spirit moves. God, help us to be receptive. Help us to respond in correct ways to what you're speaking to our hearts. God, we love you. We're grateful. We sing you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.